it was a joke, it was just an intention, just that time. Okay, well, welcome to the Football Club's Championship Ball Trade Dinner. Can I ask you please to be upstanding from the top table, Arbroath FC's chairman Mike Kerr and the second division chauffeur.
Good evening. Welcome to Arbroath Football Club's 2017 Hall of Fame dinner. Which not only to receive three inductees into the Hall of Fame of Arbroath Football Club, but also to celebrate the achievement last season of Arbroath Football Club winning the 2016-2017 League Two Championship, and I think they deserve a round of applause for that. It's good to be here in Ayfield. I just hope that it doesn't get any more windy than it is right now, but it's a fantastic setting, and a lot of people here that I've known over the years, and good to see you all, and we've got all sorts of things for you tonight. As I said, there is the Hall of Fame. There'll be three inductees tonight, and the three inductees, and we'll do that later on, will be John Petrie, Eric Sellers and Stevie Florence, who've all gave tremendous service to Arbroath over the years. Tonight's event is sponsored by Thorntons, which is my old firm. I left them over 14 years ago, and they've just gone from strength to strength since I left. But they're doing really well, and Anne McCune's on the board at Arbroath Football Club, and and there were Scott Milne, the managing, joint managing partners here tonight, and I'm so pleased how well they're doing. And just recently they acquired a prestigious firm in St Andrews, and I see nothing but good days ahead for Thornton, so well done to Thornton, and gratitude from the club for sponsoring tonight's event. Well done, Thornton. What we'll be doing tonight, after dinner, which is about to be served, and the fair looks very good tonight, we'll do this, well, Brian Cargill will do this goal save thing, which is similar to heads and tails, and for that, everyone has to chip in £2 to participate in that, and someone will come round and take money out of your pockets so that we get the £2 from everyone. There'll also be a raffle, £10 in the an envelope, put your name and table number on it, and there's all sorts of good raffle items. I'm just picking out, there's a free Wills voucher for Thornton, so if you're thinking of dying soon, that'll come in handy. And there's a wax barber jacket donated by Gammy's Country Clothing Limited. There's a £200 clothing voucher donated by Nunners of Broughty Ferry. There's loads of other things there, and so it's I would ask you all to contribute to the raffle, please. We'll also have an auction later on, and there are There were 9 items in it. There's another item that's not been included in the programme, and that's for hospitality for 4 at Dundee United. So there were 10 items altogether. We'll do that later on. We'll split it 5 items, and then a gap, and then another 5 items. If I can introduce you now to not quite the top table guests, but the people who are sitting on my left beside me where I'm sitting. We have the SFA president here tonight with his wife, Alan McCrae. And Marlon McCrae, could you stand up, please? That's not an easy job being the president of the SFA, but good to have you here tonight, Alan. It's good that you've come to this event. Thank you. We also have 3 of the coaching staff. We've got Ian Campbell. Dick can't make it tonight, but I think it's a bonus that Ian's here instead. and I'll do a little interview with Ian later on, just talking about the championship achievement last year and how the club's doing this season. I think he had a particularly good win last Saturday against Forfar. Well done. John Young's also here. John is a man I've known for a long, long time, since the mid-80s. He was involved in our growth then with Jimmy Bowen, and he's back with the club and no doubt doing a great job. I don't know if you know or not, but apart from being a footballer in his day, John played for St Mirren and other clubs. He was also an amateur boxer, and John holds the record, the Scottish record, for the fastest knockout. 10 seconds, and he, to this day, he still can't remember anything about it. And John Ritchie's here as well, and I think, John, you're a goalkeeper. Are you involved in the goalkeeping side of things? Yeah. And John has a wealth of experience in Scottish football over the years, and it's good to have you here tonight. And then over and above that, we've got the 2 speakers tonight, and you're going to enjoy them. I'll work with them quite a bit. And their top drawer, and I could ask them to stand up. First of all, Peter Brown. Peter, would you stand up, please? Peter Brown, ladies and gentlemen. And a local lad from Carnoustie, a number of you will have heard him before, another excellent after-dinner speaker, Mr. Paul B. Paul. Right, ladies and gentlemen, we now move on to what might be said to be the serious part of the evening before the speakers come on, and that's the induction of the Hall of Fame, the 3 inductees. And the first one, and if I just read a bit about him, clearly he's not here tonight, it's John Petrie. And if I can just tell you a little bit about him, on 12 September 1885, shoemaker John Petrie scored 13 goals as Arbroath thrashed Aberdeen Bonacor 36-0 in a Scottish Cup tie. It was also an individual world goal scoring record for one game, while Arbroath's win was also the biggest recorded in a senior football match. His exploits were commemorated by Angus Council some 120 years later, when a street in Arbroath, Petrie Way, was named in his honour. His team records are extremely incomplete from that time. It's not clear when Mr. Petrie made his Arbroath debut, but his name appears in a team sheet at the tail end of the 1884-1885 season for the matches against Pilgrims of Glasgow and Queen's Park. He was undoubtedly an outstanding player, but he had a fiery temper which frequently landed him in trouble with the football authorities and led to occasional dismissals and suspensions. He was a prolific goal scorer, although we don't know how many knocks during his career. Apart from one season, 1891-92, Petrie was involved with Arbroath FC as a player, trainer and kitman for 35 years, from 1885 until retiring in 1920, when a benefit match was played on his behalf against Forfar. Mr. Petrie died on 13th July 1933, aged 65. Now, I don't think we've been able to get any sort of descendants of Mr. Petrie, but I would like to call upon to receive the award and to be inducted into the Hall of Fame, and I'd like to ask up
the club's new chairman, and a great choice as a chairman, Mr. Mike Kerr. Mike, would you come up, please? Are we ready to? We'll do Stevie first because I think we're going to do Eric now. Yeah, Eric Sellers is the second inductee, and I think we are going to play an interview. Is that right? Of Eric.
Eric Sellers, it's nice to have you with us this evening. When is it you signed for Arbroath?
1966.
And it was Albert Henderson that signed you?
Yeah, he came to my house in Invergowrie.
Well, did you ever have any doubts about signing for the club?
No.
So always wanted to sign for the club. Yeah. Your first goal, can you remember your first goal for Arbroath?
Against East Fife, Old Bayview.
Old Bayview, yeah. Good memories, eh?
Good memories. Happy days, the 1-1-0.
No, it was a tough game, wasn't it?
No, for me it wasn't.
No. None of them were tough for you, were they?
None
were tough. Yeah. None. In your career at Arbroath, what was the best match that you played in?
I would say the game at Ibrox when we beat Rangers 3-2.
What's your memories of that day?
Just the players all got together and said Andy Penman was actually playing. He was absolutely tremendous, and we just went out and played because we were all quite experienced at the time, and laughing at John Fletcher. John Fletcher scored a goal. We hit his shin, went over the top of the goalie, and in we won 3-2. But that was just one of the things that happened, like, you know.
Could you believe it at the full time that you'd actually beaten the mighty Rangers?
Oh aye, yeah. We played a lot of teams here, you know, and there are very few teams came here and beat us. In the early days, the Rangers came here and hammered us, Celtic came here and hammered us. But as time went on, we were all more experienced players coming in. What a difference it made. Good. No fear.
And you can still watch it on YouTube. The 5 minutes, the highlights of that game on YouTube of Arbroath's victory against
Rangers. I've got the disc in the house.
You've got the disc, good.
The wife hides it.
What's your own personal highlight, though, playing for and with Arbroath? What was stood out for you?
I think the way that Albert treated the boys, and most of it, like I say, in the early days, most of the boys were all local. There were very, very few boys coming from the West Coast. So it was a bit unlike Celtic. When Celtic won the European Cup, mm-hmm. all lived within, 15, 20 miles of Parkhead. Mm-hmm. Same difference here. Good. And a lot of the games here, the boys were, I was out injured for a while, and the boys were rattling in the goals, 6-1, 7-1, 8-1, you know. So that's good.
Yeah. Good memories, eh?
Yeah.
Now, we're standing at this goal, and this goal's got a particular memory for you. Do you want to explain to us why?
Yes, we had the kick-off, the start of the game, and all the Celtic boys were all admiring the ground and doing this and that and the next thing, and I thought, well, I'll just stick the ball in the net and we'll be 1-0 up.
And what time was that scored in?
It was some place between 16 and 20 seconds.
16 and 20 seconds.
Yeah. The goalie was just bending down to pick up his gloves. I'm only young.
Yeah. But it was a game that Arbroath were on top, especially in the first half, wasn't it?
Well, actually, Billy Purry had a screamer in for a second, but I was redeemed offside by the linesman. I went up and head the ball with Billy McNeil, and of course he's 6'2" and I was 2'6", and the ball broke to Billy Purry. Billy stuck it in the net here, and that would have been 2-0, and there's no way they would have come back with 2-0. Even Celtic here wouldn't have done it.
Amazing, eh?
No, in their days.
Amazing. So, you've been inducted, or you're being inducted into the 2017 Hall of Fame. What was your reaction when you heard about your induction?
I bought the wife a bunch of flowers.
Did it surprise you?
Yes, it did in a way. Yeah. There's been a lot of good players here over the years, but pleasantly surprised.
But sadly, on the night you won't be at the Hall of Fame. Why not?
No, I'll be sunning it in Spain.
I suppose, you know. Clash of dates.
There's a good chance it'll be thunder and lightning here, and might even get snow. And I'll be in the sun.
We'll be thinking of you.
Yeah,
I'll have my beer and my wine, etc. Eric Sellers, it's been a pleasure speaking to you, and congratulations on your induction into the 2017 Arbroath Hall of Fame.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
And his son Barry, who played with Arbroath, is here tonight. Barry, could you come up and collect your dad's award, please? Barry. Dad spoke well there, a bit much better than you, yeah.
Not like him, to be fair, not like him. So it's a huge honour, it's a privilege for him, very proud of him, obviously. He talks very well, once he gets going, very, very well, about his days. But no, unfortunately I was a little bit young to watch him, but by all accounts he was quite a good player.
So. Yeah, he's a legend at Arbroath Football Club, isn't he?
Well, legend's a strong word, of course. he obviously did enjoy it, and he obviously was quite good. Some of my ex-managers and coaches speak very fondly of him. We've had some fantastic memories of him playing and not playing, and some of the games that he's been involved in, and it's a different world to what we're involved in now, unfortunately. They were, in his words, proper football players who could all play to a very, very good standard. So,
well, Barry, we're grateful to you for coming up and receiving that award on behalf of your dad. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The third inductee tonight is Stevie Florence. Stevie, at 13 years of age, was told that he would never walk again after being badly injured in a farm accident. But he showed tremendous courage and resilience to bounce back, and he went on to make 372 League and Cup appearances for his hometown club during an amazing 18-year spell at Gayfield. His 372 games places him second behind Tom Cargill in the post-World War II appearances chart. Much of that time was spent on defensive duties, and as a consequence, Stevie only scored 4 goals. He was part of the team which won promotion from Division 3 to Division 2 in 97-98, and was in the side which went up from Division 2 to Division 1 in 2000 and 2001. Stevie played under 15 or 16 managers at Arbroath, and he rates, no surprise there, and he rates former Celtic and Scotland star Danny McGrain as the most influential. It was amazing having him here, as he was a fullback like myself, so that was interesting. The whole town was buzzing at the time, and my family were all delighted because they are all Celtic daft. Or just daft. He played against one of his trickiest opponents were two Dutchmen playing for Rangers when the Lithies faced them in a couple of Scottish Cup ties. Michael Molls and Peter Hoekstra were probably the best players I came up against, and it was great to test yourself against such top-class opponents. Stevie left Arbroath at the end of season 2002-2003 to join Forfar Athletic. He played 3 further seasons at Station Park before taking 3 years out then and returned to action with Arbroath Vics, where now aged 45, he was playing until the end of last season. Amazing. Ladies and gentlemen, can I ask Mr. Stevie Florence to come up, please? You've given so much service to Arbroath Football Club, so it must be indeed a great honour to be inducted into the Hall of Fame.
It is. It's an absolute honour. privilege. And like you said, when I was 13, I was told I would never walk again, so it's just a bonus being able to play.
You were a good player as well, Stevie, and that's one thing that maybe doesn't come over there. You might have had the longevity of playing for a long time, but you were a talented footballer. And you're still kind of a talented footballer for a both legs. Tell the people what's the story there.
Well, I was playing until April there, and done my cruciate ligament, so kind of time out just now. Hopefully get back playing, because I think I'm still in my prime. We'll see, fingers crossed.
I think your career's just kicking off now, actually. Stanley Matthews, he was 50, so that's something that you should aim for. But the people here tonight are delighted that you've been given this honour, because it's richly deserved, and I just want to present the award to you.
And not only is a good footballer over a number of years, he's a very, very humble guy, and it's good to see someone like that, no ego at all. Fantastic, well done, Steve.